chasing bait prawns this morning, and they'll be greasy backs, and it's very dry at the moment, so we'll be suffering weeds and jelly balls, and hopefully no snags.
Police cars and dogs and lawnmowers, it's just you and the pelicans and the seagulls and the prawns and the fishes, you know, it's good, out amongst nature. It's a very competitive game, being drawn, because you're limited to such a small area. Like in the days when they could have just gone anywhere around Moreton Bay or the river, everybody just split up and went their own way. But now we're restricted from the river mouth up to, well, the top of the river, which there isn't much up there because of pollution. So we're all in this little confined area, and it's quite a dogfight to get the best spot. Pretty competitive, so back in the 60s when I was there on the river, what I've got now would have been considered a big boat, you know. But the way the technology's changed now, like we've got the high, we used to pull our nets up by hand, out of single cylinder.
The next ritual is after cleaning the windows.
In those days, what I got would have been a big boat, but the trawl gear that I'm towing now would probably weigh about probably 10 times what that little bar and piece of bamboo did. And you've got a hydraulic winch, and you're also pulling up under more propeller push, so everything's just a lot more strain and heavier, you know. And you need that bigger boat. You start doing turns and you're trawling on the bottom and your boat's laying over and you hit a rock or something. I've almost lost mine about 3 or 4 times, where I fell over in there, skin off me, clambering, trying to get the gear stick to pull it out of gear before it tipped right over, you know.
That a little better. Thing I'm fishing now.
years where we never saw a pelican on the river. It's only when you get that big drought out west that and they're all hungry and they take off, you know, you've probably seen it where the half of them can't fly and they stay there and die and whatever. But we got a hell of a migration of them with the big drift. And then, of course, they'd never been here before. When they got over here, oh boy, look at the tucker here. I'm not going back to bloody Lake Eyre or wherever. So we're stuck with them now until they probably die old age. The whole thing works together, and it takes a while for a lot of this to sink in, you know. Like, I suppose I grew up going fishing with Dad and that on the river with prawn, yeah. But the black shag, the black diver, not the shag, the little, I think they call them conger, I'm not sure. They're a little black bird. They eat prawns more than they eat fish. You know, you're always watching for where they are because they're going to tell you exactly where the best patch of prawns are, you know. And a lot of people don't realise those sort of things. They think you just go out there and throw a net over the back and if you pull it up and there's nothing in it, you can say, oh, there's nothing around there. That way in a deep hole or up against that bank on a running in tide, there's going to be heaps of prawns there, you know. And if you see the birds all sitting there with their wings hanging out or, you know, just hanging around close to the shore or something, you go, well, the prawns aren't working, they're dug in the mud. When you see the birds active, there they are. So, you know, things you've got to watch out for.
catch any dingers.
Big catfish got ya.
One of these, probably the one that's in here.
Oh, one of them. Oh, yeah. Gee.
I got about that much of that spike in it.
Oh. Oh.
Prawns are dear, eh?
Yeah.
We've got about five boats down here where I work that are here most of the year. Sometimes we have a few extra come from other areas and sometimes we go to their areas, but basically about five. And we're looking at about probably 10 mile of from the river mouth, 10 mile upstream. So you can't all go to one spot. That live a little bit further up and have their moorings further up will pick the areas up their end and I'll take mine down my end and, you know, so. seeing I'm the last boat downstream, I'm going to get some invasion from upstream, so. The idea is that we've got it in our head where we're going to go the night before, and you've got to be the first one to that shot just as daylight breaks. So
that's a pretty good quality bait for onto this river. All these ones here are good eating for Rob. Hard to beat actually, a flavour. Waste selling them for novices to put on fishing line.
These days, a daylight on a certain tide where you know that that action is going to happen that I was just talking about, so you want to be there, you know.
These are fishermen's nightmare.
If you get that first shot through there, you might get anything. I've had 225-pound, 250-pound in one shot, in a 15, 20-minute shot. And the next guy will come down just as I've winched up, and he'll run through that same area and he'll get 70 pound. And then he'll winch up, 70 pound, turn around and go back through it and he'll get 25 pound. And then it'll be 25 pound there for the rest of the tide. So, you know, you can imagine how important it is to get that first shot. Go down there rubbing your eyes, you haven't had coffee or anything, your hair's curly and sticking out the side and you're half asleep, bloodshot eyes from yesterday, and you roar down there just on daylight making your cup of coffee as you're going and trying to steer with one hand, you know, and you get down to just the last bend before where this shot is, and you see this little white light up ahead of you, and as you get a bit closer you discover it's one of the opposition's just big. You know, and you go, I could have had another hour and a half in bed, what's the point?
Control.
You can't always be number one. There's a certain gentleman in our troop that's very hard to beat. He's just really early. well.
Yeah, that's going along good, right?